Hi, I'm Mike North. I'm a principal staff engineer at Stripe and the tech lead of their developer platform org. In Intermediate TypeScript, we'll learn how to deal with advanced type information, including a detailed analysis of nearly all of TypeScript's built-in utility types. By coding along with us in this course, you'll learn advanced concepts around generics like type parameter constraints, conditional types, the infer keyword. We'll dive deep into covariance, contravariance, and what effects those have on generic types. We'll learn how to handle different types of modules, like MJS files compared to common JS modules. By the end of this course, you'll be well on your way to becoming your team's TypeScript expert. The next topic we're going to cover is nullish values. These are dealing with like values that might be empty or not yet populated. We talked a little bit about null, undefined, and void in terms of like them being, you know, unit types, but let's talk about like when it's appropriate to use undefined versus null. And then we're going to get into a couple topics here dealing with like, how do you work with nullish values? How do you safely do that? TypeScript provides us with a couple different things, several operators here, all four of these are TypeScript features that have a particular syntax that you can use that relates to, you know, handling nullish values. So first, let's look at null. So null differs from undefined in that null is something that has to be explicitly set. So I tend to use null to mean that nothing is here. Like somebody has filled in this field and the field contains nothing. Null. It is distinguishable from undefined. Undefined is, it indicates that something may not have ever been set in the first place. So where are we going to see undefined? Well, anytime you have an optional property, right? On an interface, I can say that. Date has the possibility, or so completed at has the possibility of being a date or being undefined. And you can see here, if we're saying, all right, I've got a form in progress, you know, interface, I have a value that describes this form in progress. And I want to then pass it into this, I want to use it to submit this form. Sorry, let me get the tooltip here. It's lagging a little bit. Come on, give me completed at. So that is new date. But if we look at the type here, it's still type form in progress. This is going to indicate that it's undefined because that's how we've ended up with this. It's really coming from this type annotation here, right? It's going to say like, oh, the value you gave me certainly meets this interface. And if you want to regard it as this type, of course. Oh, sorry, I'm getting a little confused here. Completed at versus created at. We could put a completed at here just for fun. I think the example still works. Yep, it does still work. So yeah, we happen to be providing it in this case. We have both dates. But here, if we're saying my date equals form in progress, whose type is the interface above, right? It's the interface on line 11, which represents that completed at may not be there. If we try to go ahead and grab it, it has the possibility of being undefined. So this is an interesting thing here. TypeScript has a new feature that we'll learn more about later called, it's a satisfies keyword, which would make this a little bit neater. It would allow us to say like, oh yeah, we are a form in progress. We are type equivalent to that, but can you go ahead and keep the most specific type you can so that we don't lose the fact that completed at is actually present. It is present on this particular variable. So we'll learn more about that later. That's undefined. Void, we talked about void just now. It means, you know, the function's return value should be uninteresting. Console.log is an example. Like, don't listen to what console.log returns. All right, let's get into how we work with these nullish values. The first of these operators we're going to describe is the non-null assertion operator. So here we have like a grocery cart, this fruits and vegetables property, they both may not be present, right? So we're going to create a cart called grocery cart. It happens to not have either of those two fields on it. And we can see that if we just try to go like cart.fruits.push, we're alerted to the possibility that cart.fruits is possibly undefined. Adding this exclamation mark right here, that is the non-null assertion operator. What this means is plow straight through. Does that sound safe?
What could possibly go wrong?
What could possibly go wrong? Seems like a great idea. It's not. It's not safe. That's not to say that this is useless, but this will error. This will error. Fruits is, in fact, not there. So this will throw. Now, where might this be useful? Well, I use this all the time in tests. Why? I want things to throw if they deviate from my expectations in tests. It's perfectly fine for them to throw. That is a test failure. So it's a little bit like an assertion in a test. It works beautifully in test libraries like Mocha, for example, where assertions are the mechanism of like, thrown errors are what happens when assertions fail. So if you have other thrown errors that are part of your test, it'll be caught just like an assertion failure, and in most cases, it'll be surfaced very nicely. There are test frameworks that don't behave that way, but I like when throws, even if they're not part of a direct assertion, it's just like this function was not happy and it threw. I like that to be handled in a very visible way. Yes, sir.
Is that similar to like that annotation you had where you told TypeScript to ignore the next line, or is it more specific to like just that one?
Very good question. Yeah, we could do this. Could do that. So let's try that instead. Actually, I'm going to leave this example. Let's try it up here. So it would make that error go away, but what about this? Oops. I'm lagging a little bit here. Should this work? There's a difference between turning TypeScript off and saying specifically, please just ignore the possibility that this one thing might be null. So that's part of the value here. Like, you don't want to sort of say TypeScript, literally, like, get out of my way on this next line. Like, don't do any type checking, don't error, I don't care what it is. Versus this is a much more precise way of saying, I want you to ignore something very specific, and it's the possibility that this one thing is null. Let's look at a more modern place where we see declaration merging in, you know, at play. So let's create a new class. I'm going to call this fruit2. And I'm going to give it a name property, which is optionally present. It's a string. And I'm going to give it a mass property, which is a number. I'm going to give it a color, which is a string. And then let's give it a static field called create banana. And it's going to return a... Yeah, that'll work. Thanks, Copilot. So great, we've got fruit2. Let's apply the tests we just learned to figure out what's on this declaration. So I'm going to change this to fruit2. All right. So fruit2 is a value. A class is a value. Maybe not super surprising. Classes exist in JavaScript. We can call like new fruit2. Like, we're using it as a value there. So this isn't super shocking. The create banana function is there. This is almost like the jQuery case where we have the class where we can like invoke it to create an instance of fruit2, but we also have this thing dangling off of it. So this is almost like a namespace here, the static side of a class, right? And then let's look at this. We've got fruit2 type test fruit2 equals empty object as any. Fruit2
is passing the test for a type. And we can see that when we start to pull things off of this type, that's evidence that like these properties are present on the type. What we're seeing here is that we have been benefiting from declaration merging whenever we've used classes. It's an interface for an instance of the class stacked on top of a value declaration that represents the class itself, the thing we invoke when we say, I want a new fruit too. It's passing both the value test and the type test. So now there, the tooltips here, let me put fruit two down here just so you know nothing's up my sleeve. It's not showing us multiple things here. And that's because this is a super common use case. And it's like an optimized way to represent this. It's the class fruit two, but there is declaration merging at play. There is a type on this thing. There is a value on this thing. Whether you want to call create banana, like the static methods on a class, whether you want to think of that as a namespace or not, it's up to you. It won't break your mental model either way. Because remember, a namespace is kind of like a value. And so we could say, oh, well, it's like a separate thing from like the class definition and the constructor, right? Or you could think of it as like, okay, this is one big value. It's not quite like a function, right? Where, you know, it's not quite like the jQuery case where we literally have a function called dollar sign. You could think of it either way. But classes are both types and values. So I submit to you that like there is declaration merging happening here. There is more than one thing riding on a single identifier. At the beginning of the course, I promised that we would think about utility types that come with TypeScript. You can think of this almost like a standard library that ships with TypeScript. And we're going to start digging into them now because we finally have like all of the elements we need to tackle a few of them, right? Conditional types are a big part of some of these built-in utility types. So first, we're going to look at extract. The purpose of extract is you want to obtain some subpart of a type that matches another type. So I'll show you an example. So we've got favorite colors. It's a, you know, medium cardinality union type here. There are a lot of things that it could be. A lot of string literals. We've got a tuple here with three numbers. We've got an object that represents red, green, blue. It has properties, red, green, blue. And what we can do is say, I want to extract the subset of favorite colors, which is assignable to type string. What do we get out? Only the strings. If we want to get the types that are assignable to objects, we only get the one object. Sorry, we're comparing to this type. So it's just like, give me those parts of favorite colors that are type equivalent to an object with a red property, which is a number. And there we go. We get that. And then the tuples, we could do that too. We could get number, number, number out of this. We could also do this. Is that going to work? Nope. I have to do. Is that going to work? Yep. Anything that's array-ish. Get me the subpart of favorite colors that is array-ish.
Doing like an implicit satisfies in the inside.
Well, let's pop the hood. Let's see what it looks like. There's your conditional type. So let's see if we can understand this. I want to go through the next type because it's kind of the opposite. And we can look at how these two types work simultaneously because they're sort of like one is the anti of the other. So this, instead of saying, I want to, like, it's not just hand me the piece of T, that is type equivalent to you, we're saying, hand me the piece of tea except for the stuff that is type equivalent to you. So you're saying exclude anything that is you-ish. So let's look at our non-string colors example here. And we would get the tuple and the object. We're saying, get rid of anything that is assignable to string. Give me the rest. Exclude those things that are assignable to string. So here's how they work behind the scenes. I've added an underscore so I don't collide with the real definition here that TypeScript provides, because you can't redeclare type aliases. So let's break this down. And let's keep this in mind here. So if we said, I'm going to bring the other example lower so we can have it all in the same viewport here. Let's look at extract first, since we covered that first. So what we're saying here is T extends U. So as long as T extends U, evaluate out to T. Otherwise, evaluate out to never. And here's something important to observe about the way never behaves in a union type. It disappears. It's like it was never there, right? So now go back to remember, like when I showed this union type, remember we said like, back up here, this example. Remember we had like 10 or 2? And I said that, I'll leave these both up. I told you to think about this as equivalent. These mean the same thing. Boolean. So when we see this top example, 10 or 2, it's as if we're evaluating piece by piece and unioning them all together. And so if we go down here and we think about this extract, we're going to one by one take those things that are in favorite colors, and we're going to, if they match you, in this case, it would be like, is the dark sienna, is that a subtype of string? Sure it is. Okay, that's T. That's dark sienna. We'll call this a running type. And we're gonna do a couple other strings. And then there'll be a bunch of things that don't match this condition. And those will value out to never. And the nevers just melt away. That's how extract works. That's why it's convenient to use never here. We're taking advantage of the way that it's sort of the union sort of fans out. And then the things that match our condition, they sort of pass straight through. And then the things that don't, they turn into nevers. We union that together and the nevers melt away and we're left with only the things that match. Exclude, if we bring this down, we'll bring it up so you can see it above. Wow, it looks like very, very similar, except the condition's flipped. Those things that match string, they will turn into nevers. Everything that doesn't match passes straight through. We union all of the results together. The things that matched to string melt away because they turned into nevers, and we're left with only the things that did not match the condition. That's exclude.